Starting a sermon series on juggling life. How many of us often feel our lives are like that? We're juggling chainsaws because we seemingly often have so many things up in the air. And it often gets us into a great deal of trouble. And so over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be talking about juggling life and juggling those things. And we're going to talk about some of the spiritual dangers because frequently, spiritually, we're juggling chainsaws. And hopefully by the end of this series, you'll be juggling something less dangerous. 9 chances out of 10, you're still going to be juggling because life is that way. But hopefully instead of chainsaws, maybe you'll be juggling scarves. Or at least balls. And so let us pray as we turn to God's Word to see how He might help us with this juggling we find ourselves in. Let us pray. O gracious and loving Lord, we pray now that as we meditate upon Your Word, as we remember what it is that the Apostle Paul gave as practical advice to those early Christians, that we too would see the practicality of this passage for our lives. Lord, help us as we work our way through this sermon series to slow down and juggle less, or at least juggle everything more safely. And especially help us, Lord, to juggle in a way that doesn't harm us spiritually. So I pray that you bless this series and you bless this word, Lord. Push me aside and make these words pleasing to you and to you alone, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Are you feeling all right? I think you might be a little sick. You're not looking too good yourself. Are you feeling okay? Are you feeling ill at all this morning? A little bit, a little green. Are you feeling? You guys are happy, but still you're not looking. Are you feeling okay? You sure? You're not. Things aren't. Especially with Ravens jerseys on. You must really be sick. You know, as I look around our congregation, I see a number of sick people. I hate to break the news to you, and psychologists have given us a diagnostic tool to determine how sick we are. And so, see if you answer affirmatively to one or more of these questions. If you do answer so, I want to suggest this morning that you might be sick. Do you ever find yourself moving from one checkout line to another because it looks shorter or faster? Do you ever note the number of people in each line and multiply this number by the number of items per cart to figure out who's moving faster in the line? Do you do that? How about this? If you're still standing in line waiting to be served at the checkout, and the people in the other line get to go before you, do you feel annoyed? How about this? Do you count the cars in front of you at a stoppage or slowdown and either get in the lane that has the least number or is going the fastest? Do you do that? Do you notice tractor trailers, buses, or dump trucks at stoplights or slow spots and do all in your power to avoid them? get around them and get in another lane? Do you do that? Do you find yourself multitasking to the point of forgetting one of the tasks? Have you ever accidentally put your clothes on inside out or backwards? Do you sleep in your daytime clothes to save money, to save time in the morning? Good idea, isn't it? I'm going to try that one. Do you constantly look at the watch and say, just look at the time, I'm going to be late? And this is for Bill Ball. Did he slip out? He's probably doing something. Where's Bill? Okay, this is for Bill Ball. Do you find yourself habitually looking at your cell phone, obsessively checking it when no one has called you or messaged you? You do any of those things? How many people said they did one or two of those things? Well, if you did, you might be suffering from hurry sickness. Did you know that? Hurry sickness. How many of us are familiar with hurry sickness? It's actually a term coined by two cardiologists from San Francisco in the 1950s. They were studying heart disease, and they discovered that one of the contributing factors to heart disease was busyness. Obsessively busy, overly busy, and that contributed to heart disease. And they gave it a label, hurry sickness. In fact, the same two doctors also gave us that wonderful designation as type A personality. How many of us are familiar with a type A personality? Now, I wonder if anything has changed from the 1950s. What do you think? I think many of us would return to the 1950s, wouldn't we? And we'd say, wow, that's a slow time. If anything, things have gotten worse. Social scientists point out to a couple factors, facets of our society that our forefathers and foremothers wouldn't have even thought of. One of the things all around us is complexity, isn't it? Complexity. We have to learn more to stay on top of things. The technology that promised us to have lives of leisure really has made life much faster, hasn't it? Think of all the things you got to learn and relearn and unlearn just as technology sweeps us along in its path. And so we live in an increasingly complex society, and it makes us busy. And along with that, we live in a society that has just all sorts of opportunities and choices. And human nature, the way it is, we want to take advantage of all of those opportunities. You ever find yourself unable to say no? We all want to do those good things, and so we have all of these opportunities. Maybe years ago, growing up, you just had one or two things you could do on a Friday evening or a Saturday evening. Now you have all sorts of options, don't you? And so we try to do them all. And we're busy. No, I think we're busier now than we've ever been. I think hurry sickness is prevalent in our culture as much as it was in the 50s, if not more so. In fact, a study, an article in Psychology Today confirmed that very fact. One of the studies in that article said a study of 10,000 businessmen and businesswomen in the United Kingdom discovered that hurry sickness was present. It was widespread in that cultural group. In fact, the article goes on to give you and me a definition of hurry sickness. It goes something like this. Hurry sickness is a behavioral pattern characterized by continual rushing and anxiousness, an overwhelming and continual sense of urgency. You ever feel that sense of urgency? You don't know where it's coming from? Are you feeling that sense of urgency now as I'm preaching? And you're going, come on, Pastor, get it over with. That might be hurry sickness. Or just maybe that I'm laying a big goose egg. Hurry sickness, it goes on. If that wasn't bad enough, it adds these words. It says, hurry sickness is a malaise in which a person feels chronically short of time and so tends to perform every task faster and to get frustrated when encountering any kind of delay. That's hurry sickness. Does it sound familiar? Maybe close to one of those affirmative answers you gave at the beginning test? Does it kind of look like that guy juggling chainsaws? Well, what does Paul say to us? Here we are in Ephesians, and Paul is offering that early church just some practical advice. There's a whole set of household codes. There are a whole set of morals here, just kind of practical teachings that Paul's offering those early Christians, and I think they're as applicable now as they were back some 2,000 years ago. And what does Paul say? Well, he starts out by saying that we should be careful how we live. Not as unwise, but as wise people. Verse 17, he says, "So do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is." So Paul's contrasting two ways of life, a wise life or a foolish life. And he's saying you've got a choice. And of course, he invites you and me to be wise. Then he states some of those things about wisdom. He said, don't get drunk, but be filled with the Spirit. Be thankful, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, right? Giving thanks at all times. So he's offering us the way of wisdom. Now the Bible says a fool is someone who says in his or her heart there is no God. But Paul is saying to you and me, if we're going to live a life of wisdom, we need to live it to God. Jesus said, a wise man builds his house on what? My words. And the rains will come and the floods will rise, but the house built on my words, my commands, my teaching will stand. But a foolish man builds his house on the sand. Not on Jesus' words, not on the teachings of the Lord. And when the rains come and the floods come, that house is smashed. So Jesus is saying, live wisely, not as a fool. Live for God. And then he reminds you and me of an important facet of living for God. We often don't think of it. He says, making the most of your time. I don't know about you, but I tend to think my time is my time. Paul is reminding you and me that our time really doesn't belong to us. It should belong to God. So he says, making the most of the time that we have. Greek scholars point out that that word for making most is one word in Greek. It comes from the commerce industry of that day and age. It had to do with buying out, buying all, buying everything, buying back. Was a word of commerce. It was often used of buying slaves. They bought slaves. It was used in that term. And so when it was translated into Christianity and other places where it says that Jesus bought us back from slavery to sin and death, that's the term used there. And so it was translated as he delivered us. He set us free. He rescued us. He redeemed us. In fact, that term in the Old King James Version is closer than many modern translations. It says, redeem the time. Are you